Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
And congratulate yourself with a round of applause for being here today. To raise the price of your wages all across the state of Michigan, the next voice you hear after mine will be Reverend David Bullock out of Detroit. He's a great advocate. He's been on the ground fighting with us. I'm going to repeat that, fighting with us, since we've been engaged in this. Give him a hand. Along with Pastor Jeffrey Hawkins, but we come together, we gather here on this day to talk about our next steps. And I know you all want information. We can answer a few questions for you, and I'll be here throughout the full duration of this event. We'll be in the back to answer questions. But I want to tell you a little bit about how we got to this predicament and the next steps to continue this fight for our rights here in Flint, and also for the rights of every Michigander throughout Michigan. Now, maintaining our focus is important. Maintaining our focus. Now, what has happened here is a byproduct of a failed experiment called the Emergency Management Law.
Yes, sir.
Governor Snyder did not only ordain and sign this poor legislation into law once, but he did it twice. He did it against the will of every Michigander in the state of Michigan after it was voted down.
He got paid for it.
And then, well, if they're paid for it or not, but he did it twice. And these unilateral decisions with these dictators that come into communities like Pontiac, Detroit, Bear Harbor, Flint, these are the poor decision-making of this law. And so Governor Snyder, this falls firmly at his feet. We have been impacted severely here, and this should never happen in any American city where our community is poisoned by its water. And I do want to thank the people who've been steadfast in this fight. You all, Bethel United Methodist Church, the place that we sit here, has always opened its door and been very welcoming to us. Give them a hand, please. Now, where we are now did not just start today. It started back in 2012, putting us on this road to disaster. And thanks to Rachel Maddow, MSNBC, and other programs like her, we got the national attention that we deserve to overcome this. And this is going to be a journey for us all. And good information is what you should seek out, because bad information can be as toxic as the water that we've been consuming for the past year. And we're going to be steadfast on that pattern, giving you good information. Now, back in the back is my assistant, Candace. Candace, raise your hand. Everybody take a look. Give her a hand. She's been taking the phone call, getting information. So we have a chronology, a history of all the things that's taken place over the last couple of years. And this is available through internet. This can be emailed to you, or you can get a physical copy while they're last, making sure that you understand fully what has happened, so they won't be able to paint a different picture than what has been done to us. Also, before I bring up Pastor Bullock, we want to talk about the next steps, because we got to maintain our focus. I'm going to keep telling you about focus, because focus is going to be key in this fight. Unity is going to be key in this fight. Now, what we have to do, there's going to be a rally, and Bullock is going to talk about that. That's going to be at the Capitol. Now, this is going to be one of many. Bullock has made three rallies, which led to the resignation of the DEQ director. All right? We help facilitate them as the Legislative Black Caucus. We have been facilitating some of those things there in Lansing. Now, I'm going to bring up my colleague that represents Flint with me. I'm one of your state legislators. The other state legislator that represents Flint is Phil Phelps. Come up here with me, Phil. Give him a hand. They define me as the pit bull in Lansing, but he's the mad scientist. He comes up with a lot of great things as he stands up here with me. But this is what I need you to do when you get to Lansing, and part of when you get there. There is a water ability accountability package that's been put together by several legislators. This is to put laws into place where this tragedy never happens again in the state of Michigan. We can only do things by laws. We are legislators. We create laws. And so what has happened to the laws and the water accountability package that myself, Latonya Garrett, Bill Phelps, Stephanie Chang, and other legislators have put together, the Republicans have assigned these things to committees never to give them a second look. Okay? So I need all of my advocates, I need all of the warriors out there to advocate giving us a fair look, giving Michigan a fair look, fighting for Michigan families as you can do. When you get to Lansing, I want you to take these notes here, because I'm gonna give these out. These are each one of the bills, and giving a summary of each one of the bills and what the bill is to accomplish. Giving you information about where the bills have been assigned to, the committee that's been assigned to, the committee chair that's over that committee, and their contact information. So what are you guys gonna do?
Call!
When you get the answer, what you gonna do?
Call!
Well, I want all of my warriors out there moving this legislation, because legislation cannot be moved unless the committee chair gives it a fair hearing, and these are all Republicans. Every chairmanship in Lansing is controlled by Republicans, okay? Bill Phelps has introduced a bill that when they falsify public documents, when they knowingly falsify public documents, what should happen to them? That's what Mr. Phelps has introduced. Now, we know that, give him a hand. Now also, we do know this, let me get your attention, because this is a very important part of what we need to do with our next steps. We do know that we have been exposed to lead. We do know our children have been exposed to lead. We do know that we're gonna have to fight through that in the future with our children. Anemia, ADD, attention deficit disorder, different things our children are going to be faced with. When those kids engage the institutions of education, our public school system, our public school system are going to be left with the charge of trying to educate these children. Now, let's not get it wrong. These people are still going to have productive lives, but we have to be able to educate them appropriately. And it's going to take dollars and cents to get these children educated. I've called for the governor to forgive the debt of the Flint public schools. So we can start to repurpose those dollars that's owed to the state of Michigan, because the state of Michigan owes us. They need to repurpose those dollars so they can build the infrastructure to educate those young people, so they won't just give them more drugs. Put them in special ed classrooms. One of them is to be a good troublemaker. We need to make sure these young people will have an opportunity to have a life moving forward. So I need all of you, with me and my colleagues in Lansing, to call for him to forgive those loans. They're due us.
Yes.
They're
due us.
So without further ado, I'm going to give it to Reverend Bullock. He's going to talk about the mobilization effort that we're going to have. But I need all of my warriors out there. I need all of you to make sure if you can make it to Lansing on next Thursday, to do so. If you can't make it, call. If you can't call, email. If you know somebody with email or cell phone, tell them about the information.
Yeah.
All of you are now enlisted into the war. You are the new army for the city of Flint. Give yourself another round.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now also, as we try to disseminate some of the products that is needed for waters for families, and I haven't given it to my wife. I've never seen anybody wash collard greens in a single bottle of water, but she was successful in doing so this past holiday. So we know this can be a costly factor for us all, but water is being delivered to all fire stations inside the city of Flint for pickup, and there's going to be many more sites where you can pick up bottled water. Now, we do know, when we say pick it up, everybody's not able. Everybody's not, has a car. So all of you as the warriors, you're going to have to make sure if your neighbor, your friend, your sister, your brother, if they can't do it, we have to do it for them.
Bring the state in to do it.
Well, they're here, we're delivering, but they need water today, Tony. They need it today. They need it right now. And so all of us have to make sure we are our brother's keeper. Am I right? Now, I do have a few water filters on hand, and we do have a few cases of water, but we want to make sure that those individuals that cannot get out to any other place that may be here today gets that water first. Okay, so we want to make sure they get that water first. But if you need a filter, Candace will take your name. We'll get what we have to you today. We'll make sure you know about the locations where they are. For all of you who are enlisted into the Army, if you want the chronology, the history of what has happened inside Sarah D. Flint, we have it here if you want. The contact numbers for the bills and everything else that needs to happen, we'll have that information for you. And don't be mistaken. Emergency manager rules still applies to the city of Flint, Detroit, Bin Harbor, all of the places that they've taken over. What they have now is called a transitional advisory board and a city administrator that's left with the executive orders of the emergency manager, which is the grandchild of Governor Snyder. Now also, I'm gonna be calling, can you guys keep a secret? Okay, I'm gonna share my secret with you. I asked Governor Snyder and the rest of his individuals to pick up the tab for the city administrator, which makes $145,000 a year. Not only $145,000 in salary, but they get a $6,000 car allowance. And a $1,200 cell phone allowance. Which the contract was signed with the city of Flint, putting all of our taxpaying citizens on the line for that. So I'm asking the governor to pick up the tab for the remnants that he's left here in this community. So these are our next steps. These are our next fights. These are our next challenges. If we stand together, if we fight together, if we work together, we win together. Yeah. David Bullock, before you come to the field, you want to say anything to the
club? Yeah, that was great.
I would be remiss if I didn't say just a couple of things, especially about Arthur Woodson right now and him and the work that he's been doing. But there's a lot of credit that a lot of people don't know, because sometimes, you know, you send out a press release, you try to get something out, and it's just hard to get it out. But so several months ago, I heard from somebody that wanted to stay confidential on something, somebody that didn't want to be outed, didn't want to lose a job. But I heard that there might be some issues that we needed to look into, and we needed to FOIA some documents. And this was just shortly before the lead story started to break with Virginia Tech professor Mark Edwards. And we sent in these FOIA requests looking for these documents, and they fought us. They said that they weren't going to give us documents. Then they said that there wasn't any documents, and I had to go lawyer up. I had to get attorneys to help bring these documents.
Thanks, put some stress on them.
And even with the attorneys, they started saying that they didn't have any of these documents. So the only thing I knew, the next step, I had to go to the media, because we had to keep fighting this, because I really thought that there was documents out there. And after I went to the media, Arthur Woodson called me, and I had never met Arthur before then, but he had a couple of documents that he had got a year and a half before, when they didn't realize that how bad that they had made the situation, and they were still releasing a few documents here and there. And I took those documents, and one of those documents had word for word what we were all looking for in my
opinion. Yes.
So even though those are only maybe 20 or 30 pages worth of documents, Arthur Woodson spurred the legal status that my attorneys needed to start hammering the DEQ, the state's attorney general, the Department of Treasury, and the city of Flint that was under emergency management, to turn over those documents. And then just about 3 or 4 weeks ago, because they had to honor my FOIA request, they had to honor the one that Mark Edwards was doing, the one the ACLU was doing, and just when they said they had no documents for me, they turned over 10,000 pages of documents. And it's because Martha Whitson just taking a whim and giving me a call, and everything that he's doing, I just wanted to say thank you. And he's been, just one little thing can spark another. One little action can start an avalanche. And that's exactly what happened here. And I'm glad that everybody is staying on top of this. And I'm glad that I've got a partner in Lansing, Sheldon Neeley. He, day one of January last year, when he got sworn in, this story popped up with the TTHM, and he was on it. He had fire on him, and I was excited that we had somebody that we were going to be able to work together and get some stuff done. And I know that I'm painting a rosy picture here right now of something that happened that was very bad for the community, but everybody here, we stay positive, we work together, and just those little things that start a spark, and that little spark starts a fire, and we keep growing and growing. We're going to take care of each other. And you know, everybody's concerns about, you know, when these water bottles are going to get out. Well, they done messed up. They gave Sheldon their phone number. So I don't know if you guys know Sheldon, but if he wants to get a hold of you, he's not going to let go. So I'll stay here and answer any questions you guys might have after this thing goes around.
Nothing, baby.
Go after the ball, fellas. Let's go nuts.